Peatland has been a major energy hub for the last 50 years, critical to the growth and development of the UK offshore oil and gas industry. We've built an extensive skills base, developed a network of critical energy infrastructure, and created a diverse, well-equipped energy supply chain. Now, with climate change and a green economy at the top of the global agenda, Shetland has an opportunity to become the UK's first green energy island. The Orion project was launched in April 2020 as a strategic framework to connect organisations with a common ambition to transform the Shetland region into a centre for secure and affordable clean energy. Alongside partners Shetland Islands Council, Net Zero Technology Centre, Highlands and Islands Enterprise and the University of Strathclyde, Orion will harness the power of Shetland's natural assets and energy expertise to produce wind and tide-powered green hydrogen for local use by 2025. To sustain and create 500 net zero jobs by 2030 and assist the just transition, develop skills for the workforce of the future, and build a healthy, sustainable economy for Shetland, Scotland, and the UK for decades to come. Orion has big ambitions. By harnessing Shetland's natural offshore resources and repurposing oil and gas infrastructure, we can become a world leader in green hydrogen production, which will reduce our current dependency on oil and gas, help alleviate fuel poverty through clean, affordable energy, protect our natural environment for future generations, allow us to supply the UK and Europe with hydrogen exports, while building a clean energy industry in Shetland, which will supply energy to Shetland's homes and businesses. Join us as we put Shetland at the heart of the UK's energy transition.
There can be no doubt that humankind needs to urgently respond to the challenges of climate change if we are to continue to enjoy everything our planet has to offer. Offshore wind farms are the backbone of the country's future energy system, providing vital low-carbon energy at scale and at competitive prices. Capable of powering hundreds of thousands of homes each year through the renewable electricity they generate, and playing a significant role in achieving the UK's climate change targets. The completion of the Beatrice offshore wind farm was a significant step towards a net carbon zero world. After 10 years of careful development and design, including 3 years of construction, Beatrice became fully operational in the summer of 2019. With its 84 wind turbines at the time of completion, Beatrice was the largest single source of renewable energy in Scotland. Beatrice is located around 13 kilometres from the Caithness coastline in the north of Scotland and is managed from its operations and maintenance base at Wick Harbour. Building an offshore wind farm like Beatrice was a huge task, requiring the skills and dedication of thousands of people and the use of huge ships, cranes, and plant to manufacture, deliver, and install the massive wind farm infrastructure, both offshore and onshore. Ecologists were also employed to carry out marine and bird surveys and assessments. A large-scale, specialist crane ship was used to install the legs of the turbines. These structures are known as jackets, each weighing around 1,000 tonnes, the combined weight of almost three Boeing 747 jets. At their tallest point, the turbines themselves stand around 188 metres above sea level, each one 10 times as tall as the Pitlochry Dam. At the heart of Beatrice sit two offshore transformer modules which take all of the electricity generated and transform it up to 220,000 volts to be sent via the subsea cable, called the export cable, 70 kilometres to the mainland on the Moray coast, where a further 20 kilometres of onshore cable delivers to the transmission substation at Black Hillock. It is then transmitted through the National Electricity Network to power around 450,000 homes and businesses. With capacity to produce 588 megawatts of energy, that is almost 40 times the output of Pitlochry Dam Power Station. Beatrice has its own special operational base at Wick Harbour. Born out of a 200-year-old derelict building, designed by the renowned Scottish architect and engineer Thomas Telford. Following a £20 million investment on the buildings and repurposing an unused area of harbour, Beatrice now has up to 90 people who will manage and maintain it throughout its 25-year operational lifespan, generating renewable wind-powered electricity. Beatrice cost around £2.5 billion to build, one of the largest ever private investments in Scottish infrastructure. Beatrice Offshore Wind Farm is a joint venture partnership between SSE Renewables, Copenhagen Infrastructure Partners, and Red Rock Power Limited.
Peatlands are a unique type of wetland where their high organic matter helps store an awful lot of carbon, and that helps combat climate change. But they also hold an amazing variety of biodiversity, and they can, if they're functioning fully, actually help hold back water, and that can help actually mitigate, reduce flooding further downstream. Here on SRUC's Curtain Otter Tyre Farms, we worked with Loch Lomond of the Trossachs National Park and Nature Scots Peatland Action 3 and 4 years ago to restore about 60 hectares of degraded peatland here on the farm. Because about 2 million hectares of peatland in Scotland are degraded, that means that they're not actually functioning properly. The way we restored our peatlands, we actually primarily were what's called reprofiling peat hags. So that's where you have an exposed bank of peat. It's dry peat, it's emitting gases to the atmosphere. And basically we level those out, or the contractors leveled those out, and put the vegetation back on top. And that capping of the peat, that can actually help stop the peat drying out, and therefore reduces the amount of carbon that's been released up into the air. But it also, over time, will help the peat rewet itself naturally. And we are very keen here at SRUC to understand how our peatland restoration has actually helped potentially mitigate flooding further downstream. So we have a variety of sensors out across the farm, and they're sending data, information, across an Internet of Things radio network. And that data is collecting information on soil temperature, but also soil moisture at different levels in the soil. And we're also looking at river levels. And we're particularly interested to see how does the restored peatland actually help hold back water, especially after extreme rainfall events. Scottish Government, Nature Scot, they've got a target to restore 250,000 hectares of degraded peatland by 2030. And if we can achieve that, the amount of carbon stored in those restored peatlands will go some way to helping Scotland achieve its journey to net zero by 2045.
To be in a native woodland is a totally different feeling to being on an open hillside or to being in a conifer plantation. It just feels like a natural place to be, and you know, there's a feeling of safety there, which is quite intuitive, I think.
What I really notice is the places I love most in Scotland are the places that have good amounts of tree cover. You see all the different birds and the wildlife that's in there, and it looks incredible.
At Glenlude, we have an amazing project trying to transform the conifer plantation into native woodland. Native woodlands are so important because that's where wildlife thrives, and it's a much nicer place for people to interact with.
At Shehalion, we do lots of tree planting, vegetation, wildlife monitoring, everyday site maintenance, as well as leading volunteer work parties. Our volunteers are amazing. So far we've planted about 7,000 trees. It's pretty inspirational.
It is a huge amount of work that we want to do. There are a lot of trees to be planted. Just £10 can help plant one tree, and once that tree is planted, you know, it will become many other trees, and those trees will be in the ground for hundreds of years.
We hear so much about it now that the climate is in crisis, and it really is about time that we do something. We need to do something urgently about it. I think tree planting is probably one of the biggest things we can do to reverse that, to heal the land in some way. Any money that's donated to this appeal will be really well spent. It's not just for right now, it's for future generations.
This appeal is hugely important. Please donate wherever you can.
Thank you.
The estate were approached by Penny Lawson at Spey Catchment Initiative, who was looking to undertake some works on the Calder, which was apparently a very degraded water course.
So we're up here in Glen Banneker, just above Newton Moor. This is the River Calder, you can see behind me. At a glance, it looks like a pristine, very natural, perfect environment. But the reason we're working on this river just now is because it's been picked up for a number of years now that this particular tributary of the Spey is not producing as many juvenile salmon as you might expect it to. And we think that that's because there's very little woodland in the catchment, which is not really helping the functioning of the river overall, and it's quite an unnatural situation.
So naturally, the channel would flow through woodland and wood would fall into the channel. Wood itself is fantastic for habitat, for fish and invertebrates.
But what we're aiming to do here is to give nature a helping hand by putting felled trees, which we've harvested somewhere else from within the glen, into the river. So mimicking natural dead wood that would be falling into the river if there was woodland within the glen.
The woody objects that we call them are basically large coniferous trees that were taken out of a wood close to the river.
We knocked down trees, we dragged them to the sites that have been located by the consultant, and then we just put them in where X marks the spot. These are plantation trees that the plantation is worthless. It's coming down anyway, and the estate has told us to help ourselves to what we need to make the project happen.
The second part of what we're doing in this glen is going to be to establish riparian woodland, which will be a case of planting native woodland species, native tree species, along the river banks. So as that grows up, that will provide a natural source of deadwood to keep that whole cycle of deadwood in the river going.
From the estate's perspective, there will be some hopefully relatively minor maintenance whilst the trees become established, and eventually the fences should be able to come down and that will be easier to maintain. It will also look a lot better.
It's probably been a 2-year run into this project, you know, liaising with the estates, liaising with contractors. You know, it's all about the bigger picture of working with people as well, you know.
There's another really important advantage to having wood in the channel is that it gradually raises the bed of the river because it stores sediment in behind these bits of wood, and that connects the river to its floodplain, which is a healthy process. And that's great for towns like Newton Moor downstream, and if we get the river flooding here and connected to its floodplain, it reduces the peak flow downstream in the town.
So we've been very lucky in receiving grants for this project, and the main one, certainly for the riparian woodland, which we're going to be doing in the autumn, is from the Scottish Natural Heritage Biodiversity Challenge Fund. And they've very generously given us sufficient funding to defence the riparian areas in 3 sections and to do the ground preparation.
But I think it's part of a wider belief that conservation and habitat enhancement is very important to the estate, and this ticks all of those boxes, I would say.
The two projects together should make a really significant landscape scale difference to the renaturalisation of the whole glen, which we hope will be a really, really good investment for the future.
Our nation of Scotland is intoxicating, but it's not the country we imagine it to be. When you gaze at our majestic mountains and glens, do you see raw beauty and drama, or do you see the devastating truth that lies hidden? We may not realise it, but our Scotland is one of the poorest places for nature on earth. Gone are the once vast forests, rivers and wetlands teeming with life. Gone are the animals hunted to extinction, and many of those left teeter on the edge. Our Scotland is one where millions of treeless acres dominate the landscape. Centuries of burning, draining, felling and excessive grazing pressure has disrupted nature's balance. It doesn't have to be this way. This is our Scotland, and you and I and everyone living here has a choice.
Do we choose to expand our natural pine forests into huge areas of trees and shrubs and wildflowers, a place full of birdsong and animal tracks?
Do we choose to breathe new life into our oak woods to clean our air, improve our soils, and help fight climate change?
Do we choose to have wildflower-rich meadows in our towns and cities and create places where our children can develop, explore and play?
Do we choose oceans teeming with countless fish, seabirds, whales and dolphins, full of food and supporting coastal communities who can rely on nature for their living?
Do we choose to have rivers surrounded by trees and allow them to meander naturally through our landscapes, filled with salmon and patrolled by otters and osprey?
Do we choose to repair and reawaken our damaged peatlands, to store carbon, purify water, reduce flood risk, and provide a home for our mountain hares and golden eagles?
Do we choose to again live alongside animals that once lived in Scotland and belong here?
This is our Scotland, and we stand at a crossroads. We have to ask ourselves,
Do we choose a new relationship with nature? Do we choose to acknowledge that we are but one species living in a huge, sprawling, complex living system that needs to be whole to keep it working? Do we choose to value our wild places for everything they provide, not just for their financial return? Do we choose to be global leaders to take on the very big and very real threats of climate breakdown and nature loss? Do we choose life over continuing to climb? It's up to us, but doing nothing won't cut it. That time has passed. I choose rewilding, where the rich tapestry of Scotland's nature is stitched back together to allow wildlife to flourish and people to thrive. What will you choose?
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 It's a strange thing, life. And an even stranger thing is time. No living thing knows quite how much they have. Wandering in an innocence, unaware of when the clock will stop ticking. So when you consider how rare and raw life is, you begin to think about how best to live the time that you do have. How do you make your life count? How can you leave a legacy? Throughout the course of my own life, I've spent time in a number of ways, and there are many moments I reflect on with a manner of regret. But one thing I never regret is spending time in the wild. There's something satisfying about moving through a functioning ecosystem. It triggers instincts and feelings which have been wired into your genes for thousands of years. I think it would be a slight crime to call it a pastime. I see it more as a biological necessity, like water and air. Time in the wild can solve a manner of problems. It's something I hope future generations can experience. I actually hope they have a better experience of the natural world than I did. You see, the wild can be a tricky place to find. But I'm not going to depress you and tell you that we're doomed. I'd rather tell you that thousands of people are now involved in making sure they leave their country in a better condition than it was when they arrived. Now is the time when native forests grow up the side of the hill again. When fish spawn in rivers of which they were previously absent. When the seabed is left alone to recover. When natural processes restart and missing species help us put right hundreds of years of overindulgence. So if we think about our legacy, surely we need to find our place in the landscape again. Living in a more harmonious fashion with our surroundings and playing our part in a picture which is much bigger than one species alone. Think about a wee fish travelling thousands of miles through sea and river, and their primal incentive is to give life to a generation they will more than likely never lay eyes on. How poetic and meaningful and fulfilling would it be if we could help encourage the wild for the benefit of those who we will never know? Helping not only our country, but our planet to breathe, function, and prosper. Surely that's a worthwhile way to spend one's time. This is the time when we turn it around. But the wild needs your voice. The wild needs your time.
Fiji has some of the most resilient reefs in the world. Under a 2-degree warming scenario, Fiji's reefs are the most likely to survive. These corals could be used to reseed reefs around the world that have died in 20 to 30 years' time. But if we don't stop the local anthropogenic threats, then these reefs will not survive. In Fiji, we have a problem. We have poor waste and pollution management. We have agricultural runoff. We have deforestation driven by agriculture. We have overfishing. We need to stop these issues if we are going to save our reefs.
These actions are causing damaging ripple effects that we are witnessing in real time, that seriously threaten the survival of our coral reef systems and key marine species. My name is Natasha Morosi. I'm the Director of Conservation for Bang Adventure Divers and the Program Coordinator for My Fiji Shark. Our solution is to establish fully protected fish banks, allowing marine biodiversity to expand and to overflow.
My name is Jody Smith and I work with Matanataki. At Matanataki, we work with private sector businesses who can bring about transformational change to the environment and to Fiji's reef systems. In Fiji, our waste has not been managed properly historically. Most of our dump sites, they sit on the coast. They sit on mangrove. We were walking on one of these dump sites earlier today, and it's basically a floating mass of waste.
That entire zone, that entire dump is actually floating in a marine ecosystem. My name is Paul Evers. I work for HG Leach and we run the only international standards landfill in the South Pacific on Fiji. The Vulavulasara project is a visionary project to contain, manage waste away from the marine ecosystem, away from the coastal areas.
Vulavulasara will enable the recycling of 80% of that waste stream to recycle and upcycle materials, and particularly plastics, so they can be repurposed within Fiji and the Pacific.
I'm Sanjeev Chand, the founder of the Fertile Factory and Company, and one of the directors of Waste Clear Fiji Limited. We will be replacing imported chemical fertilizer. We will be making a natural product using what is now considered waste. So the wasted opportunities, which is all the biomass, green waste, will be turned into a product that would be a natural fertilizer. And once we unite our farmers with our natural products, the impact, the devastation that has been caused by chemical runoffs from these fertilizers over decades on our reef system, slowly but surely, we will turn that around.
We're able to bring government, the private sector, the general public, the communities, we can all come together, and of course the donors and the investors, we can all come together to solve the problem. I think this is something in the past that has been missing. Multiple stakeholders, innovative blended financing, and local solutions. We haven't had this bigger picture approach, and this is what this program is providing.
My name is Amanda Ophoff and I work for the peatland team in FLS. This is just a short video to tell you why I enjoy working on peatland restoration. Up until recently, this was a commercial conifer plantation. It's one of the largest lowland raised bogs in Scotland, and it was therefore decided to restore it back to its original habitat. And that's what I enjoy most about this job, is seeing these transformative changes happen in a relatively short amount of time. Peatlands are a special habitat in itself, and watching them recover is just incredible.
Hello, I'm Ian McKee, and I work for Forestry in Scotland. So why do I like working in peatland restoration? Well, firstly, it's doing something positive to both the climate change emergency and the biodiversity crisis. Secondly, I get to visit peatlands like this all over Scotland, from when we first discovered them on maps, through surveying, and then actually watching them respond to the restoration treatments that we've carried out. But also it's working with all of the people. So when I first started, there were only a handful of people working peatland restoration throughout Scotland, but now we've got 10 people working full-time, dedicated to delivering and planning peatland restoration projects. It feels like one big team, all working together to try and do this the best we can do for our peatlands in Scotland.
My name is Matthew Cook, and I am a peatland restoration forester for Forestry and Land Scotland. It's my job to survey peatland on the National Forest Estate, to create restoration plans, and to manage the contractors doing the work on the ground. Today, I'm here in Galloway. It's a beautiful day, and I'm at a site we call South Dee. And as you can see behind me, this is a successful restoration site. This area of flatland here was afforested, it was then clearfelled, and a few years ago, it was restored by our team of contractors. Hydrology of the site has been returned to a more natural condition, allowing for the regeneration of peatland vegetation. And as you can see, greening up very nicely. And this is what it's all about.
One of the signs we look for is a high water table, which you can sometimes make out by the squelch in your wellies. The other one is key plant species such as the cotton grass here, but the real species we're interested in are these guys, sphagnum moss. They grow when there is a high water table, and they're the key species in forming peat in the peatlands. They lock up carbon, so whenever we find these guys on site, we know the site is doing all right.
Hello and welcome to the Highlands of Scotland. I have been invited to join the South of Scotland Golden Eagle Project at a fairly secret location. We are near a golden eagle nest, and there are some climbers that are down the cliff that I'm sitting at the top of, and they are there collecting a golden eagle chick to help supplement the population of golden eagles in the south of Scotland that aren't doing so well by bringing in new animals that will grow to maturity and build this population into something much, much stronger and a thriving population. And so I'm here really to document and to show you guys what the project is all about and what goes into translocating golden eagles. Golden eagles once covered the whole of Scotland, as well as much of England and Ireland, but are now largely restricted to the highlands and islands of Scotland. In recent decades, the number of goldies in the Scottish Highlands has begun to gradually increase. In contrast, however, the south of Scotland has too few eagles still remaining for a successful breeding population. And this is where the South of Scotland Golden Eagle Project comes in. By relocating eagles from the larger highlands population, it's expected that the southern population will begin to breed and hopefully thrive. So, during the cold, wet, early Scottish spring, a team of golden eagle monitors have been identifying nests with twins, only wanting to source eagles from territories with plenty of offspring. It is one of these nests that we have hiked out to today. First of all, John, the man responsible for the eagles during the translocation, fills a carry basket full of moss bedding, while the climbers prepare for their descent into the nest. Golden eagles build their nest or eyries on steep, inaccessible cliffs, and this is the biggest challenge in collecting a chick. While the climbers do their thing, the rest of the team must just wait. Eventually, the suspense is broken as we see Lewis return with precious cargo secured to his rope. This is where the veterinary team take over. The vets do a thorough check, examining eyes, listening to hearts and lungs, checking joint mobility, as well as taking blood samples for further investigation and forensic samples to pass on to the police. As soon as Gabby and Neil have finished their examination, Gabby carefully takes the young eagle to the carry basket, removing the hood put on to keep it calm. Once secure, John begins the steady trek back to the waiting vehicles. Once the team has made it back to the road, the young golden eagle is carefully secured in the vehicle before driving to the release site, where the eagle will spend the next few weeks. So that's the eagle all collected. It's in the vehicle. The team are now taking it down to the south of Scotland, where it's going to go into an enclosure ready for what we call a soft release. In the next video, I'm going to explain what a soft release is. We're going to talk about and hopefully show the eagles being fed, everything that goes into looking after these golden eagles. So please like this video and subscribe. If you want a notification for when I post the next video, hit the notifications button. But I will see you in the next video.
A giant radish and some other ones. When did we plant these? Just a few weeks ago, wasn't it? They've grown quickly.
And especially this one.
Especially that one, yeah. These are marigolds, aren't they? They're good for, you can put them in salads, or they keep beasties, or they keep nasty beasties away from the veggies, don't they? Nice. So, and then there's some beans there as well, aren't there? Can you see the beans?
More marigolds.
More marigolds, uh-huh. And what
tomatoes.
Have we got here? tomatoes.
Giant tomatoes.
Yes. We're waiting for them to go red, aren't we?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Chair of the Bracken Tory Generation Group. We've been going for around about 3 years now, and we're just trying to improve the things in the area that we live. We'll have about 700 homes in the area, and we're trying to, in this particular area, we're trying to make a nice green space so that people can appreciate it. The local people are working with us and working on it to get them aware of the things that are involved in climate change and things, so we're going to put some trees in, and we're going to involve the local schools so that they can also become more aware of climate change and our impact on the climate. And it's just generally to make a nicer space, this particular space, for people. We've already done things like window boxes during COVID. We put those out to some of the residents, and we're putting out some wildflowers on planters and things in some of the greener areas that we have, and that's basically what we're about.
Last week we had quite a few people in the community came along to help us with our sort of first efforts to change this piece of green area. It's been particularly bad over the years, full of rubbish and then choked with rubbish, so we've cleaned it all out. And we are now starting to do the land. This is going to be our wildflower area. We turned it over because it all has to be sort of rough ground for the seeds to go in. You can't just put the seeds in grassy areas because they just get choked. So hopefully within the next few weeks we'll be planting our seeds. The children are coming up from the school to do that on the 6th of September. So that should be good, and they should be showing in the spring. So that's
we've managed to get free trees from the Woodland Trust, so we will be planting quite a few shrubs and trees in the area as well, which will obviously help with climate change and to make the area more beautiful, and hopefully people will respect it and not throw rubbish on it, and that's what we're hoping.
Well, there's two aspects to this project. We've been approached by all the residents here, there's a lack of car parking. So we looked at a number of sites for car parking, this seemed the obvious one. And then we got approached from LEG, the Lochaber Environmental Group. They were looking for a site for an e-bike station. The e-bike station would involve a charging hub and also a stand for the bikes. So we explored about three or four different sites as a group, and then we identified this as being the best group. But then, through the kindness of David Mee, a local architect, we prepared this plan. And this plan illustrates how we can achieve the e-bike station as well as 18 parking bays. We then did a survey of all, with all the houses around here. We did a leaflet drop through all the houses, and we had one expression of concern, but everybody else supported it. So taking it from that, we then advised LEG that this was the best site for the e-bike station. We then had a consultation with the council's housing department, and they've now agreed to make the site available for an e-bike station. This all ties in with the council's active travel scheme, whereby they want people to walk and cycle, and because this is obviously better for the environment. So I think that's it really, Karen.
I'm a project officer here, and welcome to our community orchard. We have 25 growing boxes dotted throughout the village here, and these are full of vegetables for everyone to help themselves to. These boxes at the moment are run by Ellie, our Mifu gardener, and volunteers help with the growing boxes as well. There's all fruit trees planted here, and these are planted by the community. And that was all started back in 2017 with volunteers, and then from 2018 we got got some funding from the Climate Challenge Fund, and here we are 4 years later, and we're just in the middle of running a project all about food waste. And we also run a project with the school, which is all about helping kids to grow, cook and eat their own food, and also working with them to get the school composting at the moment. So that's it. We're a team that have worked with lots of different community groups, and we just try and engage as many people as we can within the community. We have our orchard space here. We have lots of people coming down to help with the events and like trying to get interested people to join in, and it's been a really great community space for people. We also help with the community fridge, which is again it's a partnership with the Miravoir Development Trust and the school, and is run by volunteers, and that's all about reducing and reducing food waste and sharing it with the community. And we run lots of different projects within our group.
Okay, my name is Anna. I work for Velocity Cafe and Bicycle Workshop, and I've been working in partnership with Merrin from the South Keswick Residents Association to organise a litter pick and to do it in the greener way as possible. So all the rubbish we've collected, we are taking by e-trike to the dump today. This is kickstarting a bigger project of Merrin's, where they're working on a big community cleanup which will be ongoing for the months ahead.
Afternoon and welcome to the Seabird Community Polytunnel. My name is Norma Bonfer. The Seabird Community Polytunnel was founded in 2016-2017 and was headed up by Ross Balfour. In March 2021, the group was taken over by a new committee. Ross had a vision to provide provision for sustainable local produce which reduces carbon footprint to be used and sold throughout the village. This weekend we have started to sell the produce that are being grown within the polytunnel, and as you can see we have hundreds of tomatoes which are not ripe yet. But at the weekend, we sold £70 worth of potatoes, which were enjoyed and loved by everybody that bought. Ross left the community with a major task, but also a wonderful legacy. Since taking over the chair, I have thoroughly enjoyed working with the community and pulling together to make his vision a reality.
Climate change. Is it real? False? I decided to ask an expert.
I've worked for the British Antarctic Survey for 25 years. I was a glaciologist. Climate change today is being caused by our own release of greenhouse gases to the atmosphere through industrialisation and the fact that there are more and more people living on the planet now than there were, shall we say, 200 or 300 years ago. The chief problem with climate change is the water cycle. There are going to be many people in the future who are going to be living in countries where there is just simply enough water for their continued existence. This is particularly true in southern Europe, when all the projections are that places like Spain and Portugal are going to get drier and drier in the future. So the first impact is on the water cycle. The second impact is on sea level. Present projections show that sea level is going to rise perhaps by a metre by the year 2100. It's the displacement of human beings from where they live now because of sea level change and because of the change of moisture content of the air, food production will have to shift, and that will have a big impact on us all. I doubt that climate change itself will destroy humanity, but I do see that if climate change goes the way of unfettered climate change, there will be a lot of public dissent.
Though small in the grand scheme of things, there are those in Inverness who take part in the fight against climate change.
Well, Extinction Rebellion is really me and you, it's everybody. It's not any kind of exclusive group you have to become a member of, and it's really for anyone who's concerned about the kind of issues we're facing.
So Extinction Rebellion has three demands at the moment in the UK. Number one is tell the truth, and that's all about government declaring there is a climate emergency and working with other institutions, you know, predominantly the media, to communicate truth to the public. The second demand is Act Now. That's all about getting greenhouse gas emissions down to net zero by 2025 and stopping biodiversity loss. And the third demand is creating a citizens' assembly, which will lead the government on making the changes that need to happen in order to slow down climate breakdown.
Raising awareness is the number one activity, causing disruption, because, you know, we've marched, we've signed petitions, nothing's changed. And it has, you know, the activities we've done have actually created a lot of publicity and non-violent civil disobedience, which is key.
Even politically, there are parties that were founded on the belief of being eco-friendly.
Well, the Scottish Green Party are a party in their own right, part of an international group of Green parties. The whole system of capitalism that doesn't take account of the future, its only purpose is to make profits. Really, the companies that were benefiting from climate change had an awful lot of power and still do. We really need to change the whole system.
A system we are a part of. We the people, the average person, are also responsible for the negative effect on climate change. We demand a supply that requires the destruction of the environment. But all together can also be the heroes of this story. Supply requires demand. We just need to change our demands. But there is a sacrifice.
Climate change is a real issue. It's just not a comfortable issue. In the end, it does mean that people like you and I have got to change our lifestyle. We can't expect technology to just solve the problem of climate change. It requires individuals to do different things in the future than they might have expected to do. The average person's contributed to climate change mainly by, I think, their travel, by car or by airplane. This in itself creates a carbon problem from the emissions from the cars and from the airplanes. It's what you eat, how you dress, how hot your house is, and how much you travel. It is a difficult decision that people have to make, is whether to really take climate change seriously. And if you do, you question everything you buy, you question everything you eat, you question where you travel and why you travel, and you stay as locally as you possibly can. The other thing that we can do to reduce our individual carbon footprint is to buy less. It's to buy things that last and not be swayed every moment by what's the most topical thing to buy that year. Fast fashion is probably a third of all producing all the gases of climate change. A third of it is fast fashion. So just buy what lasts and don't buy too much, and cherish what you own rather than feeling you've got to buy something new. And that would make a considerable impact as well.
You don't need to buy the latest stuff, the cheapest stuff. You can go to secondhand shops. You can swap stuff with your friends. You know, there's ways to do it.
And this is a very simple thing to do. You eat less meat, you eat more vegetarian food, and you in fact help the entire environment.
So the way you shop is political. Organic food is so important, you know. I hope you include this, because pesticides are killing the bees, killing the insects. We need them for survival.
People should start to live in cooler homes, wear more sweaters. It's quite simple. And it's this very uncomfortable feeling that once you know about it, you can't go on as you were, that makes the topic one that's not brought to the surface that often.
Long.
80 years.
80 years.
It's great. We can be part of the action.
What action?
Climate action.
We can all help to be useful again.
At the Cordell Primary School, we are collecting our waste and turning it into something useful. We are making foil blankets from our crisp packets.
The OP at La Cardle isn't just a conference of parties, it's collect our packets. The blankets can be used for outdoor learning, for emergencies, or for donating to charities to help homeless people.
We are excited to be reusing and reducing our waste. This helps to reduce climate change.
Hi there, my name is Rebecca Dunphy and I'm part of the team delivering our Climate Challenge funded project Seasons of Change at the Larrigan District Learning Center. LDLC is an independent learning center with charitable status based in Larrig, Sutherland. We offer learning opportunities to people of all ages across the rural communities of Sutherland and wider online. Seasons of Change offers training to help Sutherland Rajshahi students reduce waste and increase food growing and cooking. This project increases understanding of climate change in the local community through a series of classes, workshops, and events. Since the beginning of April in 2020, we have worked with over 800 students, not far from hitting our project goal of 1,000. As well as our amazing selection of tutors that we have within the Learning Center, we also partner with amazing organizations to deliver their programming to our students. We offer a wide variety of classes and workshops, but the three main areas we focus on is food waste reduction, textile waste reduction, and habit change. For food waste, we do a lot of online gardening workshops, such as polytunnel growing, get into growing for beginners, and composting workshops. We have a lot of different initiatives where we give seeds to local schools or homes. We have seasonal foraging both online and in person. We have video content that has cooking tutorials or growing tutorials. So far we've had over 200 people take part in our growing projects. For textile waste, we do a lot of sewing that teaches people how to make their own clothes or mend the clothes that they already have. This includes our Garment of the Month program, Beginner Sewing. We do eco-dyeing and furniture upcycling, as well as initiatives such as green greener Christmas that helps you reduce the textile waste that you produce over the holiday season. We've had over 160 students take part in our sewing programs and always love seeing what they create. When it comes to habit change, we have classes such as mindful consumption, climate aware food choices, and different programs with the Love Food Hate Waste. We work to incorporate climate change into every one of our classes. Our students are often surprised that these activities they are passionate about, such as gardening, sewing, or cooking, can help reduce their impact on the environment. If you're interested in keeping up to date with what the Learning Center is offering and with our Seasons of Change project, you can subscribe to our newsletter, follow us on Eventbrite to be notified when a new class is opened, follow the Learning Center on Facebook or Instagram, or head over to our YouTube page to see recordings of our past classes or any other video tutorials that we have available.
Day dawns, and I am practicing my purpose once again. It is fresh and it is fruitful if I win, but if I lose, ooh, I don't know. I'll be tired, but I will turn and I will go.
Only guessing till I get. Beats Queen and Art by Dexter Stones. We join the surfers against sewage, million mile beach, clean. We record time every time we go to the shore to collect rubbish.
All the cars running fast along the interstate can feel the love that radiates, illuminating what I know is true. You can ask me how, but only time will tell. The winter's cold, but the snow still lightly settles on the trees, and a mess is still among.
We made a huge wave with nets and rope we collected from the shore. Sometimes we do yoga when we go to the shore. I like doing yoga. We made posters and there will be more to see. Yoga now.
And all the children walking home past the factories can see the light that's shining in my windows. I write this song to you. All the cars running fast along.
I learned animals and sea creatures will be safe because of our beach cleaning. Shrew, ocean school, seagrass,
white red rolls. Even after all the promises you've broken to yourself, all will be well. You can ask me how, but only time will tell.
Seagrass is good for biodiversity and provides cover from currents and waves. It also absorbs a lot of carbon and nutrients, which is good for fish food and the fight against climate change.
All the children walking home past the factories can see the light that's shining in my windows. I write this song to you.
Find an abundance of channel serrated bladder and egg wrack. We also find kelp, limpets, whelks, wrinkles, orange and red beaver and sea truffle, barnacles and pigweed.
You can ask me how, but only time will tell. You can ask for help, but only time will tell.
Ocean's Cool Beauty Products by Vivian Stones.
Have I been sleeping? I've been so still, afraid of crumbling. Have I been careless? Dismissing all the distant rumblings.
Island, I see we can be used sustainably. If you take too much, it will harm the environment. And all the seaweed products we have researched have been environmentally friendly. Local school fertilizer by Sophie Harding. We had an open afternoon for our seaweed fertiliser. People came from as far as Waterness and Glasgow to get some fertiliser. We used our fertiliser in the Polar Tunnel too. We had a vote on which charity to support. We collected £311.14 in donations for the Whale and Dolphin Trust. I'm looking forward to meeting the produce that has grown because of our fertiliser.
But this is a willingly bird and we've not forced it to come to us and it's wild.
Hey penguin.
He hurt penguin.
Tell us more.
Bobbing head.
Fall over.
Hi, my name is Freya Burns. I'm a research consultant at Changeworks, and I'm going to talk to you about a research project that we're currently delivering, funded by the European Climate Foundation. The context for this project is the target of achieving net zero emissions by 2045, and balancing this with achieving a just and fair transition to net zero. How we heat our homes is a huge challenge in terms of carbon emissions, and it also has a huge impact on people's lives, their comfort, happiness, and finances. Our project is looking at how to achieve a just transition to low carbon heat in off-gas areas. We have developed four potential models which could be used to roll out low carbon heating systems. We see these models as providing alternatives to the current business as usual approach, which relies on a fragmented supply chain and can be very challenging for consumers to navigate. So what do I mean by models? Basically, the way in which a consumer purchases a new heating system or energy efficiency upgrade such as insulation. This includes who owns it, what the consumer journey's like, who's responsible for maintenance, and how the energy bills are paid. The models that we've developed sought to streamline some of these things. The main bulk of the project work has been a widespread consultation exercise with supply-side actors such as network operators and manufacturers, as well as community groups and consumers across all three housing tenures, owner-occupiers, private and social rented sectors. I'm going to briefly talk through these four models and then share some of the feedback that we've received from our consultation. One thing to note is that these models shouldn't be considered in isolation as a one-size-fits-all solution, and they can all be implemented in parallel, depending on the consumer needs. It's also worth noting that we would expect the models to be supported by grant funding for those who require support. The collective purchase model is essentially bulk buying in order to reduce the upfront costs of heating and fabric upgrades to the property owner. Current examples of this are oil co-ops or buying clubs to bulk purchase heating oil at cheaper rates. A purchasing group could be a self-organised local community group, a social housing provider or local authority, or even a third-party intermediary or a one-stop shop who provide additional services such as quality assurance, procurement and advice. The payment plan model aims to remove the barrier of upfront costs. We all know that low carbon heating systems and energy efficiency upgrades are going to be pricey, and costs for heating and fabric upgrades are spread over time, with some payment methods including servicing and maintenance for the duration of the plan. The model can be delivered through a number of financial mechanisms, including loans, equity release, on-bill payments, or salary sacrifice schemes. Other, more innovative mechanisms include heat plans, which bundle the new heating system, any energy efficiency upgrades, servicing, maintenance, as well as an agreed amount of energy into a fixed monthly price. Similar to mobile phone contracts, heat plans can be pay-as-you-go or a fixed price. Alternatively, green leases can be used, which seek to bridge the divide between landlords and tenants by splitting costs and benefits between the two. Property assessed clean energy, or PACE, are common in the US and are being trialled in Europe. Repayments are made as part of property taxes and are based on the equity of the property. In the community asset ownership model, heating assets are collectively owned by users, as is currently the case on metered estates with communal LPG storage tanks. This could include heat networks or shared ground arrays for individual heat pumps. This model could work well for multi-occupancy buildings, such as tenements, on a whole village scale, or even just between two properties. The difference with this model is that a third party could be used to manage the communal asset, providing servicing and maintenance. In this final model, the third party ownership model, a third party pays the upfront cost to install the heating system or fabric upgrades and recoups their costs from users whilst retaining ownership of the asset. The third party may be an ESCO, utility company, local authority, a community group, or a partnership between a number of groups. The third party recoups the cost of their investment through a standing charge added to monthly billing, or through a heat plan, which I described earlier. As well as providing the capital investment, the third party owns and operates the infrastructure, and they are responsible for servicing and maintenance. Third parties may be able to lower the cost for consumers by utilising their heating assets for grid balancing or demand aggregation. This table shows how each model has so far been perceived by the various stakeholder groups. Those in green were well received by stakeholders. Those in yellow show that while there was a good level of acceptance from stakeholders for the models, things need to be put in place before these could work, things such as regulation or policy changes. And those in red show that the model was unappealing to stakeholders. The collective purchase model has been well received, and there is potential for cross-sector working between the housing tenures. Payment plans were accepted in principle by most stakeholders, although the admin barriers would need to be overcome. The legacy of the Green Deal also came into play here. The community asset ownership model was less popular due to the time and resources required. However, stakeholders expressed that the communal element of this model should be built into other models where possible. The third-party ownership model also received mixed responses, with the main barrier being selling a property where a third party owns the heating system. However, this was the preferred model for the supply-side stakeholders due to the possibilities for grid management. Whilst the stakeholder engagement is ongoing, some clear themes have emerged. There is a recognised need for approaches which can deliver at scale and an openness to the models which have been put forward. The successful implementation of any model will require steer, policy decisions and actions from Scottish Government. Ultimately, this research is intended to be used as an evidence base to inform policy and the direction of travel for off-gas heat decarbonisation in Scotland. ChangeWorks will be consolidating the project outputs in the form of an accessible evidence-based call for action. If you have feedback or would like to contribute to the consultation, please contact me on fburns@changeworks.org.uk. Thank you for listening.